What's up, ladies and gentlemen? My name is Lex Veldhuis, and it feels really good to bring you guys some Triton content.
I agree.
Normally, this was going to be released earlier in the year, but of course, with the world pandemic going on, we figured it'd be good to have some content to release later this year, so you guys still get to enjoy some live poker footage. And this is a pretty hype tournament. We have a $100,000 short deck tournament. This was recorded in London 2019 during the Triton Million. You see there almost 2 million first place prize. Lottery entries always in short deck, as you guys are used to. And there we already see one of the crowd favorites, Phil Ivey.
Scan your card, please, guys. Yeah.
Tom Dwan also at the table. Really one of the only places we get to see
on TV at some point.
Tom Dwan and Phil Ivey play.
He's on TV now.
No, I mean
recording.
You're gonna release at some point?
Yes.
This was pretty much a pop-up tournament that got so big that they decided to record the final table. As you see here, Stephen Chidwick there, and there he is, Tom Dwan. Ten Chuan also at the table, so lots of action-packed players. Gonna battle it out. Kuznetsov, also known as True Teller, on the right there. And we see a lot of limps. The antes are 30,000, 60,000. The whole table pretty much pays a small blind, and the button will pay a big blind, but it's just one and two antes to keep the action going. Otherwise the game would get very tight if the game would be played without antes, but the regular blind structure, especially from early positions. Position is very important in this game. It's a very dynamic game. Paul Phua checks his gut shots. Of course, an ace also acts as a five. So ace, six, seven, eight, nine would actually make a straight. So there you see he has a gut shot. As does Ten Chuan. Also to note in this game, a flush beats a full house. And Kuznetsov is going to go for a half pot bet here. The nice thing about betting middle pairs is that you block a lot of two pairs. At the same time, you don't block any top pairs. And top pairs are very weak in this game. They're very vulnerable, especially multi-way. They're weak, I should say. So if somebody's holding a hand like Queen 10 here with six other players, there's a big chance they're just going to let it go because the turn is going to be impossible to play. Even if they would hit a 10 on the turn for two pair, it's going to be very hard for them to think it's good once the pot blows up. And then there's also the river to take into account because, like I said, the boards are very dynamic because the deuces, threes, fours, and fives are missing. That means that there's a lot of connected cards. Ten Chuan, last to act. He's gonna call. Upgrades his gut shot to a open ender here. Gut shots are very powerful, simply because the deck is shorter. That's really the most simplistic way to look at this. King is a very clean card. He does decide to check it. There's another king, and it actually just means that Kuznetsov has the best hand with a pair of eights here, but Ten Chuan is just going to give up, and that's the end of the hand. What I love about this tour, the constant needling and the talking after the hands. I know I say it every single video that you guys see on YouTube, but it is just really special to see that people playing for these kind of stakes and needling each other. And it's great to see the competitive spirit, but also that social angle into it. These guys meet each other all over the world, compete against each other all throughout the year. Except for 2020, I guess, but as soon as everything is safe and sound, these tournaments will be happening again, and of course the cash games as well. Paul Phua here, one of the founders of the Triton circuit. Stephen Chidwick with queens. He has 20 andes. Lots of money in the middle. And there he goes. Goes for an all-in. Look at how much those antes are worth. If he'd be taking the spot down, his stack would increase with 30%. 30% of his stack is in the middle. Very much different than what you're used to with the conventional way of playing short stack when you think about big blinds. You don't very often see people open shoving for 20 big blinds or more in tournaments. But you will see it very often here, and this is not even really a decision, of course, for Kuznetsov, but he has one person behind him. So he is gonna take some time before he makes the call. If the person behind you has, let's say, a hand like pocket jacks and you just insta slam it all in, you might discourage them from entering the pot. But doing it in a little bit more elaborate fashion, like you would when you have a hand like ace-10, ace-9 suited in short deck in this situation. Mm. But of course he's gonna call. Bad news for Stevie. But hey, it's short deck, actually 26% chance. No good so far. Hearts are also covered by Kuznetsov. He's gonna need a jack or a queen. Doesn't do it, that's a 10. That's GG for Stephen Chidwick. He's had tons of success on the Triton Tour. I believe he also came fourth in the Triton Million.
This time being with aces? Waste.
Fishy
waste.
After last time, I found out that we actually have captions for the Mandarin spoken at the table now, so I will no longer be guessing what they're saying afterhand to save myself from embarrassment. See Tom Dwan here, excellent short deck player. For me personally, one of the most impressive I've seen play. Just gets away from some hands that you don't see other people get away from. Excellent post-flop as well. He's gonna make it seven antes here. He's then suited. Phil Ivey closes the action. Isn't a big blind, so to say. Has position. Queen Jack, reasonable hands. And here we see the power of the gut shots. Of course there's an overcard. But doesn't even have a heart in his hand and still has 40% against top pair. Always amazes me every single time I watch this game how close the equities actually run. And that's an all-in from Tom Dwan. Knows he has quite a bit of equity, rips it on Ivy, who has 30 antes, a little over 30 antes left. He's gonna make the call. And this is close to a race. Tom needs a 9 or an ace, as you can see. Ivy needs none of those things. And that breaks out for Tom, and that's a double for Ivy. Tom Dwan losing an all-in against Phil Ivey. What is this, 2012? That's amazing. So Tom loses about a third of his stack there.
Real American VIP.
Fake American VIP.
Then Jack 9-10. This is the best here. 40,000.
Ante is up 40-80. And here we see the payout. So Stephen Chidwick eliminated first from our footage for £315,000. As we can see, we're playing for £1.9 million. Unbelievable. A side event that pretty much got organized because people just wanted to play a tournament. Oh, you guys just want to do a casual 100k? Okay, yeah. How many people do you think we can get? Oh, I don't know. We'll ask the boys. Then Schwen, 210,000. We see Ben Lamb. It's been really enjoyable to watch Ben Lamb go through his journey of learning short deck. His first short deck tournament was played on the Triton Tour. I believe that was in Jeju. And it's really cool to see how quickly he adapts to it. Excellent PLO player. This game is much more similar to PLO in terms of betting strategies and how you plan out your strategy for a hand than it is to No Limit Hold'em. So no surprise that the Omaha guys take very quickly to this game. Tom Dwan defended his big ante, I guess you can say. On the button, has one of the worst hands in short deck, but he got such a good price with all the antes out there. He wants to see a flop. He is going to check his bottom pair. There's an ace for Ten Xuan. It gives Tom Dwan a gut shot. So he needs an 8-7 or a 6 to win. And here already you can see how dicey a top pair hand is. It might look great now, but what if the river is a 6, an 8, a king? Like all these things that are so dangerous and your hand is so vulnerable. It's actually not so bad, this hand, because I think if Tom Dwan had an open ender, he might have bet the flop. So a king and an eight are a little bit less scary. And Schwen gonna go for a bet now. Tom's getting reasonable odds. We see that he has 32%. He has to only call 1/4 of the pot, so he's profiting on that call. He does get there. River's a 6. It's gonna be hard, I think, for Ten Schwen to imagine that Tom hit that 6. I think a lot of hands that have an 8 in them would either protection bet on the flop a hand like 9-8 or would bet their gut shots that they could possibly have. So it'll be interesting to see, first of all, if Tom value bets. Second of all, what Ten Xuan will do after that. Did you see that 10? There was 6. Did you see it?
Good pre-flop size. 210.
Yeah, 7-6 offsuit is very comparable to 3-deuce offsuit in No Limit Hold'em in terms of relative hand strength.
Only because tournament. I don't value bet.
The two tournament fish, too.
Shots fired. Paul Poir put his stunner shades on. So we see Ivy call early position. You'll see lots of people opting for calls from early position. Just because you want to call often means you should also call quite often with strong hands that can stand raises. Otherwise, every time you call, people just raise you out of the pot. And every time you raise, they will fold. So very important to think about that and make sure that you don't become predictable. Just because everyone gets such good odds in this game, very important to play a lot of hands, otherwise the antes will just eat you up. If you get 7-1 on a hand, pre-flop to limp, and the equities run close, you need to play a lot of flops, which is one of the reasons why this game is so fun to watch. Ivy's gonna stab at it, top pair. We see Tom Dwan with a gut shot, gonna make the call. Ivy now also about 80 antes deep, so this is a relatively deep pot. Always very curious to see what people do with middle pairs. We saw earlier Kuznetsov making kind of a protection slash bluff with middle pair. It's very strong to block two pair hands, and you know, whatever happens on the turn, you still block top two pair. In most cases, obviously. So people go for some multi-street plays with middle pair sometimes. There is a flush draw on board, which makes it harder to get rid of some hands. Raise. My guy. All right, so Tanish one is straight rep in...
600,000.
Two pair hand there. And again, the power of the gut shot. Of course, there's a club in Tom's hand, but flushes are very hard to hit. There's less flush cards in the deck because the deuce, three, four, and five of clubs are out. That's why a flush gets promoted to beat a full house in this game. Tanchuan takes it down. Yeah, very strong play with that middle pair in his hand. That middle card pair, I should say.
I was undecided.
Very cool to see stuff like that. Tanchuan, one of the most feared short deck players in the entire world.
I just know if I shove and he calls right away, Paul's gonna call me a tournament fish, so.
Don't let him put you down, Tom.
Only in tournament, I fold. Expert play.
You fold more, it will be good for you.
Here's some friendly advice for you, kids. If you fold more, it'll be good for you.
Maybe.
We see a Paul Poir here, less than 30 antes.
Oi.
Yep, there they go. Paul Poir, excellent short deck player.
小心, 小心.
It's like 850?
Something like that. 825. No!
You're ahead.
And you might think to yourself, why would you call all in with 10-8, but he has 44%. Obviously, those percentages aren't going to look that great when somebody shows with jacks or queens.
Babies!
There's so much in that. Oh man, that fucking was just classic. Oh!
Red card.
King of clubs.
Fist back, fist back. Red card. Ah, yeah.
Oh, man, that was funny.
This solo, what do you call it? Pass up.
He just goes, fuck me.
This other pass like whore. Good cop.
GG for Phua.
Hey, tournament fish, why all in?
Because I'm a hit!
Kidding, I'm kidding. I just had to, I'm sorry.
Well, it's okay. Just now he double me up with Jack Knight also. Thank you.
My friend. Only one double.
All right, Jack 400,000 pounds to the impressive resume of Paul Poir.
Sorry. Unlucky.
Man, we see that everyone is guaranteed 514,000 pounds now.
Not even a sweat, right?
In this $100,000 short side event.
Turn a sweat?
I think buttons.
On the button?
I was under the gun. This is correct. I know, no. I let him call. I let him call. I trapped him. I trap you. I know the flop 6-7-9-1.
Here we see one of those examples of somebody limping in earlier position with a strong hand. Of course, the game is getting more short-handed. But still good to have some strong hands when you limp. It's also very hard to play post-flop in certain single-raised pots. If you make it 7 entes from early position, you get 2 calls. And it comes King 10-8 in short deck. It's just a headache. So you either get a chance to blow up the pot when somebody raises behind you. Like this board, for example, is just a headache. Look at the cute little 3% equity that he has with an overpair there. Tom already better off. And Tan Xuan, pretty much, you can almost say that he has the nuts on this board, not just because, you know, well, not because it is statistically or by rules the best hand, because obviously Queen Jack would be the best hand, but he has 60% to win this hand with all those cards out there. When, for instance, two people would have Queen Jack on this board and you'd have a set of nines, you're a favorite against two straights. Think about it also, right? Because nobody blocks full house outs and there just aren't that many bricks in this game because the deck is short. I keep saying it like that because the name makes a lot of sense. Dwan not only has, of course, a straight draw with his jacks, but the chances of somebody else having Queen Jack are also smaller. With him having two jacks. He has 70 entes behind. I wonder if we're gonna see something crazy where if he wants to push out a hand like 9-8 or 10-8. Spends a time bank chip. He has plenty of those. Gonna make the call. Daily quads, Tan Xuan, 0% for Tom Dwan. Not a great turn to say the least. Tan Xuan is gonna keep building a pot. It's a big chance he's gonna get called by straights, obviously. It's It's a little hard to imagine if Queen Jack's just gonna flat on the flop, but you know, these guys obviously try to mix it up. You don't always just want to be raising your nuts, especially in a game where the board is so dynamic. You're gonna be calling a lot. Half pot bet there from Tan Xuan. That's a call from Tom. Tom just needs to avoid disaster. Even though Tan has obviously the nuts here, it's still very interesting to see if he goes for an overbet all-in or if he feels on a paired board this bet of all-in would be too strong looking. And generally, you know, he'd want to also bet less for value. Bluffs could be a little bit cheaper because it's very likely he has a really strong hand. Betting this three times. Also, being multi-way on the flop is something very important to keep in mind. When you play against somebody and you're on the river and the turn in the river were heads up and somebody bets and you think, oh, I really can't fold here. But then all of a sudden you think back to the flop and you think, wait a minute, this person bets into five people. That can be the deciding factor in a hand.
Just that.
You what, mate? And he does go for a small, smallish bet. I like it.
920.
Think about it. If you want to go for some light value bets on this board as well. I see you have a hand like Jack 7.
I already gave you the earlier time, right?
Then you don't want to go all in either, because you're just not going to get called by worse. You definitely piqued Tom's interest. Always confuses me when they toss in a time bank chip. It's almost to me like they call, but I mean, there's actually people who use that as an angle, so always be careful for that. Try to get a reaction. Very hard for Tom to figure out. Having those two jacks in his hand, like I said earlier, just makes the chance so much smaller that somebody has Queen Jack. I always like seeing this because, crazy as it may sound, 100k tournaments is relatively small for Tom. On top of the fact that he doesn't like tournaments. Or he likes them way less than cash games, let's put it that way. To really see him hemming and hawing over 30 ante decisions is a good thing, because it means he's sharp. He's intrigued by the game. And that he cares. Doesn't like the game too much at this moment, though. Deep in the tank. Last time right now. So he has one more time bank to give after this, which means he has roughly a minute to think. When your time bank chips run out and the last 30 seconds go to waste, your hand is dead. Folds, gets rid of it. Good decision by Tom.
Can I have a spoon?
Spoon?
Chowny Ma, together! Why bluff me?
Tochi.
Ah, what?
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 Jack queen?
No jack queen.
No jack
queen. He claims I did it.
Oh, yeah.
What?
Pocket jacks.
Pocket jacks.
Yeah.
Check out the big brains on Kuznetsov.
Jack queen call fast.
Yeah. All right, 5 handed. Tom goes all in for 55 antes. One of the strengths of going all in like this is you'll see that he'll get rid of a hand like king jack offsuit. Please make me look good. Thank you, sir.
Money. Shishel Loban. Hoyo!
JJ.
You Tochi?
Tochi means bluff.
Kingpin JJ.
Prove me wrong, YouTube.
You think he bluffed me?
A 10.
I've seen him bluff.
No.
I've seen him bluff before.
No, 10-8. 10-8, never call.
10-8 would be such
you
a sick bluff.
Jack 10. These are mine, right?
Yeah. Be a 3 pair hand, which obviously doesn't count, but those hands are often used to bluff with because they block so many full houses.
What do I need to do to get extra time banks around here? If I get a heads up or something, do I get some extra?
Did you extra time banks and heads up?
No. So I'm just no time bank? No time bank time? That's how I gotta play?
You have one, don't you?
I got one. Ayo, Tom Schwen.
Time bank Tom is not a nickname I had in mind for him 10 years ago, but here we are.
Okay, check.
I thought he was bluffing for sure.
I thought he was bluffing too. That's why I spent 5 time banks. Yeah, folded anyway.
Very complicated boards here.
If I ever use 5 time banks, I'm gonna call.
Just up until that happens. Tenshuan feeling a bit better now.
I see it now.
Very likely somebody would have bet a 10 on the turn, so it's kind of hard to get value, but still good, obviously, to fill up the boat.
You know, it's like it's not only 2 million, but it's 2 million and 5 time banks in pot.
You need to win that pot. You can't lose 5 time banks and lose the pot. Time banks are important.
Chips are a lot more important than time banks. You know? When you don't have many chips, time banks don't really matter. This is what I was thinking. I was like, if I'm going to fish it off and call and lose here, I don't need my time banks, do I? Yeah. So.
Of course. Everything's easy when you're short.
Oh, yeah, Chan Shwen. Together. Why not together? Together.
They had a plan. Yeah. One of them's gonna get me, and one of them's gonna get you. And then they got each other.
I was supposed to get this side. Okay, they're already out. And then he's supposed to get that side.
Strong
he
hands.
Came after me. What's going on here?
Whoa. See how much Tom makes it here. He's gonna go all in. You do see these amounts being shoved into the middle with hands like ace king, ace queen, ace jack.
Shut.
You play way better short. Yeah.
10 bluff me.
You would be the first person to be bluffed by Mr. Xuan. But obviously we know he had the goods.
Fish, fish, fish.
Why bluff me?
Why?
Why you bluff me?
Two ace jacks so far. Ten Xuan gonna be in the mix with the queen jack. Kuznetsov. Both him and Ben Lam on 200 antis, by the way. Oh, I'm sorry. It's actually less antis. Also misspoke when I think the graphic's not updated, maybe. Because I clearly heard somebody say 4080. I don't know if that was a different table, perhaps. There's multiple things going on inside that gorgeous room. My apologies, but we'll see shortly anyway. That's the nuts for Ten Xuan. Up against the two top pairs there, second pair for Kuznetsov, I think in this case not gonna be much of an possible bluff hand, because there is already a straight on board, which makes that play to kind of rev two pair a lot less good. Now Ben Lam and Tom Dwan both have top pair, which can be good, but the fact that they block queen jack or can hit a straight when a queen rolls off definitely makes his hand a lot more interesting than, you know, a hand like ace nine, for instance. Time bank Tom, also with ace jack.
900.
Raises. Likes to see that jack in his hand. Does open up some possibilities. Almost commits himself there, has 1 million behind.
Can I have some black tea and some cut avocado with salt, pepper, and olive oil? Thanks.
Cool.
It's a healthy snack. Very glad nobody's eating gyoza. Makes me hungry. There's a flush draw on board. There's not that much money behind. Tom should be very wary of this call. It's very unlikely that somebody just decides with a hand like ace 9 or any kind of weak top pair to just think, oh, let's see a turn, who knows. The one thing that is possibly also going through Tom's head is the fact that 10 didn't raise before the flop, so very unlikely for somebody to trap limp the cutoff with two players already in the hand, with a hand like aces, kings, even tens maybe. Definitely ace king would have raised it up. So
chop, chop, chop,
cook, no chop.
No chop. So annoying when somebody says that. Chop. Nope. Well, at least I look strong, I guess.
Yeah, it's hard.
Oh, no.
And that's a GG Tom Dwan. Some rough hands for him. Take some
more money.
£514,000. There we see it in fifth. And here we got some other payouts there. So now everybody guaranteed £662,000. Crazy payouts.
Next level is going to be 35 minutes long. And I think it's 30 if it's heads up.
Yeah.
Speeds up.
On you.
It's on you, Phil. Phil Ivey. At that one hand against Tom. Chilling so far.
天天都在想，但是机会越来越近了嘛。天天都在想啊。
Tenchuan, 6 million.
Victory?
Victory!
I take.
I do believe that they're gonna shorten the levels from next round on. I think we are still on 30-60. Production crew usually on their game. Four people left. So we have Tan Xuan, Timofey Kuznetsov, Ben Lam, and Phil Ivey. Tan Xuan limping. Of course, under the gun doesn't tell the whole story now because there's only four players, so under the gun is pretty much the same thing as the hijack, I guess, in this game. Or low jack. Of course, we have the anti, the double anti on the button.
460.
I see Ben Lam using two strong Broadway cards. Very interesting to see what Kuznetsov is going to do here. He definitely sort of trap limps. But seeing as these guys are 200 antes deep. Ooh.
Good discipline.
Spicy.
Good hand.
That really just showcases again what we were talking about earlier, that
couldn't have been that bad.
Hands are hard to play post flop. Out of position with a deep stack.
Call him was 10-8.
I wouldn't call your all in with 10-8. Should just go all in.
That's true. But I don't know if you have 10-8. That's a problem.
That's called poker.
Sometimes when you get to a very difficult position somewhere on a later street and you try to find a solution, or what should I do with this hand, sometimes the answer is you should not be in that position to begin with. And kind of avoid that earlier in the hand. And I think that's what we saw Truth Teller debate there and follow through on. Where he thinks, if I'm 200 antes deep against Ben Lam playing out of position with an offsuited hand, I'm just gonna run into more trouble than what's good for me in most scenarios. We see Ben Lam going for a delayed continuation bet. We'll take it down. Queen six.
No, like you don't like to fold, Tim. Hate folding.
That he does. All right, we got an overview here of the chips. We see Ben Lam chip leading, but followed very closely by Tan Xuan and Timofey. All around 200 blinds. We have one definite short stack at the table. Who still has 60 antes? But 60 antes, you'll definitely see people open rip with, you know, the hands like ace jack, king queen suited, that sort of stuff. Pocket tens, pocket jacks, anything. Ben Lam, strong hands, will opt to limp. Phil Ivey, one of the hands we talked about, and there he goes. He's all in. It looks like the antes have gone up now. So that's 40 antes now. I think we're gonna see a call here from Kuznetsov. He does have somebody with over 100 antes that's limped from under the gun. Look at the equity of 10-9 suited there, 40%. Ooh. That's a big fold again from Kuznetsov. Ace-queen suited, four-handed against a 40 ante all-in. That's a tight fold.
Next level, 20, 100k. 60,
120.
Six.
That's a proud stack of time banks. The man, the myth, the legend. I don't think there's any way that Kuznetsov folds that there if Ben Lam isn't behind him with 120 antes. Pay jumps are very important to take into account. And the closer equities run, the more careful you should be about wagering your stack. But that was a relatively small part of Kuznetsov's stack. Just kind of thinking out loud there, because that was a rather tight fold. But obviously Kuznetsov has really good reasons for it. And I think it's very important in poker that if you see somebody do something that you don't expect, especially when you know they're a good player, it's always much better to think about why they're doing something and think about their reasoning and really try to think about their strategy in that situation. As opposed to just thinking, oh, I never see that, that's weird, that's tight, that's bad, you know? That you don't learn anything from other players if you always just kind of stick to your own beliefs and the way you view hands, and you see people do this all the time. But it's very important to keep an open mind, especially when you see the cards of somebody as good as Kuznetsov, who's one of the best players this game has ever seen. It's quite a few people who will label him as the best player currently in the game. Plays a wide variety of games, scary in all of them. It's So in those situations, it's very important to kind of try and learn alongside him or try and figure out what's going on in a situation like that. What aspects, what parameters are involved in his decision-making process. Takes that one down. We will have more episodes for you guys from extra tournaments from this London 2019 Triton Super High Roller Edition. Obviously, we had the Triton Millions. We've had some high-stakes cash games. If you guys like to see more of this content, make sure you subscribe to the channel. Very nice that we're able to put this out for you guys. Again, ace queen for Kuznetsov. Dwan with an incredibly powerful hand. One of the strongest hands in short deck. He's going to make the call. Plays so well in position. You cover so much of the board. Wow. That's couldn't ask for a better example there, I guess. Dwan with a flush draw and the open and a straight draw. Honestly, I'm surprised it's only 60% here. Normally, I'm always surprised how high the equities run. But I guess I can say the same now that ace-queen still has so much equity, but so many cards to dodge. Runner hearts is just something that you don't see very often here just because of the low amount of flush cards. And here gets showcased exactly that it's hard to play top pair out of position when you're very deep. He's gonna shove, and this is a big raise. Wants to protect his hand there. Doesn't want to play any future streets out of position. Enough money to pot for Kuznetsov. And this is a massive pot. 11.5 million at stake here.
Okay.
No, okay.
No, why? Why not okay?
I lose. No,
yeah, okay. My friend!
Oh, that's a terrible card for Kuznetsov there.
You my friend.
Spite ace. So and again, of course, the needle, these guys play against each other all the time. I have to keep emphasizing it because otherwise that might sound like a very cruel joke. And Kuznetsov is left battered and bruised. Has three antes left. Disastrous hand for him. His all-in would have gotten rid of so many. Oh, he actually did not survive that all-in. Eliminated in fourth.
So okay.
So we're gonna be three-handed now. Dwan, very scary person to be. The chip leader. Hope you guys enjoyed this episode an episode will follow. We have much more coming for you guys. Like, subscribe to the channel. My name is Lex Veldhuis. This was the Triton Super High Roller episode 1 from London. See you next time.